Joining us right now is former senior advisor to President George W. Bush, Fox News contributor Karl Rove. Karl, good morning to you. Good to see you.
Morning.
What do you think about this deal?
I think the president's right. He's unhappy with how far it goes, but he's happy with the direction he goes, and he ought to be. Remember, when we started this, Nancy Pelosi said nothing more for the wall, and then the Democrats during the negotiations tried to dramatically slash the number of beds that were available to hold people who were so-called OTMs, other than Mexicans, people who came from other than Mexico, where we have easy authority to return them. But they wanted to slash the number of beds so we couldn't hold as many of those people without releasing them on their own recognizance. Neither of those things that Nancy Pelosi wanted and the Democrats wanted has happened. The president's going to get $1,375,000,000, 55 miles of new wall. And Chuck Schumer is wrong. The president has authority. If there are unexpended balances inside the Department of Homeland Security, he can sweep those balances and reprogram those monies and I bet he does, to expand the number of new miles built and, more importantly, to repair the existing miles of the wall that we've got. We got parts of this wall, if you could see them, you'd laugh. Some of them are Vietnam-era helicopter landing pads that have been welded together, and other parts of the wall are now 30 years old and in need of repair.
But how much money is that available, do you think, in these other departments or in the Homeland Security Department that he could use?
Well, I've talked to some people who think it may be several hundreds of millions of dollars, maybe as much as $800 or $900 million. So it's real money. I mean, the president does have authority to take monies within a budget of a department and reprogram them for other purposes. He can take money that has been authorized for construction projects and reprogram that too for other construction projects. But there are a lot tighter restrictions on that. For example, they have to be construction projects that are approved by the Congress. So, you know, there are a lot, and you have to have them for specific purposes most of the time to show that it is a national security purpose, meaning in defense of the military and its mission. So there are a lot tighter restrictions on that kind of movement, but he does have authority to move funds around inside the Department of Homeland Security, and there are unexpended balances from previous years, monies that simply didn't get spent, and he can reprogram those.
Yeah. The president has certainly signaled that he's going to pursue those routes, but when you look at this, yes, Republicans got rid of that poison pill when it came to the detention beds, but he got less than half of the money he asked for, 55 of the 200 miles. To what extent is this still, you know, Mitch McConnell saying that the president has a pretty good deal on his hands. To what extent is this still a loss in terms of negotiating between the Republicans and the Democrats?
It's only a loss if he declares it a loss. Look, I was there in 2006 when we passed the original bill to begin the wall. You cannot build 200 miles of wall within a year. Take a look at last year. About $1.2 billion was approved by the Congress in March, and it took until January of this year to begin to spend that money. So the idea that we're going to be able to complete even 55 miles of wall this year with all of what that you have to go through, you have to do environmental, you have to go get that land. That land in many instances is in the hand of private individuals, and you have to either purchase it or condemn it. You have legal obstacles there, and then simply letting the contract and getting it done. If he gets 55 miles of wall built this year, good for him, but I doubt that it's going to happen, and he could not get 200 miles. Look, the president's supporters, what's the magic about $5.7 billion? He didn't get it last year, and his base didn't desert him. He didn't get that number in 2017, and his base didn't desert him. The president ought to declare this a victory because it is a victory. He's right. Directionally, the country is committed now to expanding the wall, repairing the wall, and to not doing the goofy things that the Democrats tried to do by limiting our ability to hold people who came into this country illegally and have been swept up by our enforcement people.
Karl, it's Dagan McDowell. There is,
of course it is.
You can tell by my British accent. There's reality.
You're the only person on that crowd that doesn't speak with an accent, Dagan.
Thank you, Karl. I appreciate that. There's reality, and then there is, well, what goes on in Washington. And this will come down to messaging, whether President Trump can emphatically say, this is my victory. And Nancy Pelosi, you doggone well know she's going to say there's no money for a wall. Maybe it's not a concrete wall, but the way that this is written, it's bollard fencing and levee walls to include two different types of a barrier. But you know she's going to say that.
Well, let her say it and let him go down to the lower area of Grand Valley and point out that we have barriers and obstacles and walls, whatever you want to call them. We're getting exactly what needs to be done in the lower area of Grand Valley, which is part levees. Because it's along the river, so it makes it difficult to get out of that river and climb up that steep levee. And then it's barriers. So he gets to declare victory. And you know what? The American people will see that. And they'll also appreciate the fact that the president, quote, compromised and that we avoided a government shutdown. And you can see this. Look at the last week. His approval rating has gone up. His disapproval has gone down. And I think it's because he struck that note of compromise and unity, and we're going to find a way to work this together in his State of the Union address. And I think the American people are responding to it.
Yeah, Carl, listen, I couldn't agree more with your opinion on let's not have another shutdown and have him, you know, in the center of controversy. Now, no one knows where the money is more than Carl. And so is that something that there'll be transparency to, or will he just siphon that money away and reapply it?
Oh, no.
No.
No, you have to go through a process of reprogramming. So, yeah, there'll be documents from both the department and the Office of Management and Budget. Yeah. And so we'll know exactly where that money is coming. And look, every government department has unspent money, unspent balances, and they periodically get swept by the agency and used for other purposes. But I wouldn't be surprised to see it be a significant
sum. How about Ted Cruz's idea? Use El Chapo's money. Then he could say Mexico paid for the wall.
Well, I'm not certain we got our hands on much of El Chapo's money, but it was an interesting idea. My state's junior senator is always coming up with interesting ideas and like to. Nice that he's being constructive this time.
What's the political calculus of going with the national emergency declaration? Do you think that's a big risk for the president, or do you think it's something he has to do to placate his supporters?
I do. I think the president is likely to find himself in court quickly and likely to see, unless the lawyers, I've been talking to a lot of former government lawyers, and that you can use national emergency declarations, But it has to be for a specific purpose, and they don't see the basis for it here. And they're really, the lawyers I've talked to are very worried that if he does this route, he quickly finds himself in court and finds his authority crimped. Better to start with the things that he knows that he can do. And again, we're talking, what's the magic number? Is $5.7 billion the number we have to have? I don't think so.
He had $25 billion a year ago.
Well, not for the wall.
What was it? He's thrown around 25, but he's thrown around 15, and then he went down to the 5.7, and now we're at 1.7. But yeah, no, it's sort of arbitrary in the negotiations.
Right. And look, what he's doing now is, during the campaign, he talked about building a wall along the entire 1,954-mile border of Texas, of the United States with Mexico. But he's even stepped back from that because he's listening to the experts who say, Mr. President, we don't need a wall all along the border. In some areas, there's the physicality of the Santa Elena Canyon, for example, right. 150-mile canyon in the Big Bend of Texas, where the U.S. border is about 1,100 feet in the air and the Mexican border is about 750 feet in the air. You don't need to build a wall to keep the guy from climbing down the 750
right.
feet, crossing the river and climbing up 1,100 feet.
Yeah,
the wall is not going to keep 30 more feet of wall. Ain't going to stop him from getting over the wall.
The cameras and the technology are also be
right.
critical there. Let me ask you, Carl, the State of the Union went well. His approval rating is up. Your thoughts on some of these proposals coming from the left? You've got the new Green Deal, Medicare for all, you know, 70% tax rates, completely against what the president has been talking about in terms of stimulus for the economy. What's your reaction?
Well, I think the Democrats are giving the Republicans a gigantic gift. As long as the Republicans treat these proposals seriously and make a comprehensive critique against them whenever and wherever they could. I was thrilled to see Representative Liz Cheney of Wyoming in a hearing on the Green New Deal start to ask the witnesses questions like, okay, if you want to limit the access to aircraft, to commercial air traffic, who's going to make the decision about who gets to fly and when? And I thought it was great. One of the advocates said, well, we're going to let those decisions be made by the FAA. So we now have to go to the Federal Aviation Administration and apply for air travel under the new Green Deal. I mean, talk about the nanny state. So whenever and wherever Republicans can make the case, they have to do two things. Make the comprehensive critique. Don't mock it. Don't throw it away. Don't ignore it. Take it on full
on. Ask the questions.
Ask the questions and make the points, and then propose the Republican alternative. I mean, we are, you know, when, rather than taxing people at 70%, we ought to be looking for ways to keep our country's prosperity growing and expanding and broadening. And Republicans ought to be laying out their ideas at the same time that they're critiquing what the Democrats are laying out. Because you're right, like Medicare for all. Who? Yeah, we want health insurance to be more accessible, affordable, and we want to expand consumer choice. But who wants to get rid of private insurance? Right. Apparently, a lot of
Democrats.
Especially
since right now, what is it, 145 or 150 million people get their health insurance from private insurers. I mean, this is just extraordinary.
Nearly 160 million. Yeah. Nearly 160
million. Carl, great to see you this morning. Thanks so much.